Assessing the effectiveness of a combat plane is problematic at the best of times. This becomes exponentially more difficult when that plane hasn't actually been in combat. This is the case with the CF-101 Voodoo. Many pilots on quick reaction alert wondered, would these things have actually worked as advertised? Figuring out whether everyone is wasting their time or not is a pressing question for any armed forces. Two main methods are used to answer it: operational testing and competitions. Operational testing involves setting up some pre-planned parameters and then engaging in a controlled test. This is useful in assessing equipment, but operational protocols require a more open-ended approach. In 1954, the American Air Force began a competition. It was called William Tell, after the famous Swiss story, and was held to test aerial gunnery, aerial rocketry, and ground attack skills. This was held each year until 1965, when commitments to the Vietnam War suspended competitions. The competition restarted in 1970, but would be solely an aerial gunnery competition to assess NORAD's interceptor squadrons. The ground attack component would be held on alternating years to William Tell, and was called Gunsmoke. It was divided into three categories according to type: F-102, F-106, and F-101. The top units from the Air Defense Command, Air National Guard, and Canadian Armed Forces would compete. Teams would be selected from active squadrons, and the best of each type would enter the competition. Teams consisted of an air crew, ground technicians, and air weapons controllers. Four scenarios, with mission profiles ranging from high and low altitude interceptions, as well as those under electronic countermeasure conditions, would test the flight and maintenance crews to their limits. Teams were awarded points according to their performance of each element of the team. Starting in 1972, a fifth scenario tested those air crews, regardless of type, that had perfect scores in the previous four. The winner received the coveted Apple Splitter Award, also known as Top Gun. Canadian CF-101s entered seven competitions and won three overall Top Gun awards, as well as one Top Unit Award. Pretty impressive results when considering how few squadrons Canada fielded as compared with the Americans. The first major win came in 1972, on the same day that Canada won its iconic game against the Soviet Union. Captain Lowell Butters and Captain Douglas Danko of 425 Alouette Fighter Squadron was awarded the first Top Gun Award for best overall performance in the competition. They had the most overall kills against Firebee drones, a fact made even more impressive when considering that the 1972 competition was the first time the Canadian Voodoo pilots had ever shot a live missile at a target. Pilots across the service were reassured to know that their missiles and training were effective against real flying targets. Success continued in 1978, when Captain Earl Robertson and Captain Brian Salmon won the Top Gun Award for their outstanding performance. 1982 turned out to be a bittersweet year for the Canadian squadrons. It would be the last time they competed in William Tell, as their CF-101s were being replaced by CF-18s later that year. It would also be the year that they dominated the F-101 category. 409 Comox Squadron scored the first top unit finish, as well as Major Bob Warbitz and Captain Bill Rickerts winning the Top Gun Award. The Canadian CF-101s were over 20 years old at that point, but still proved to be the most effective interceptor NORAD was fielding at the time. Canadian squadrons carried on the traditions well into the CF-18 era. Captain John Reed won the Top Gun Award in 1986, their second year of competition with the type. Hornets won Top Unit, and Captain Steve Nierlich won Top Gun in 1996. 1996 was also the last year of regular competition in response to a report that claimed the competitions put needless stress on their pilots and led to high burnout rates. One more competition was held in 2004, but has been suspended ever since. So could you say that the CF-101s guarding Canadian aerospace in the 1970s and 80s were effective in their roles? Yes. They would have undoubtedly posed a major threat to any Soviet plan of sending bombers over the pole. Would that have been enough to save us from the case of World War III? Who knows? Luckily, we didn't have to learn the answer to that question the hard way.